Children of the River, Chapter 12. Pretending she didn't see Jonathan hurrying down the hall, she stooped at her open locker, primely looped braids swinging forward. "Hey, what's wrong?" he said, puffing a little. "Why'd you take off so fast after international relations?" She stood up slowly. "And you weren't in the courtyard at break." She still didn't meet his eyes. "I'm thinking it would be better this way." "What way? What are you talking about?" He leaned against the locker. "I'm sorry, but it's better for everyone, I think, if we don't see each other anymore." "Sundara," he stood upright. "You don't mean that. You can't." She frowned. "I think you make this difficult." She glanced around. She didn't want anyone watching. "I don't want to talk so hard, but like I tell you so many times, in my country, a girl doesn't go with a boy. That the reason I'm in so much trouble." "But you've never gone out with me. How could you be in trouble?" She sighed. It was so hard to explain. "Does this have something to do with Saturday, me coming to your house?" She nodded. "They very angry I let you inside." "Oh, come on." "And then when you mention about the sailing," she trailed off, shaking her head, still unable to believe the magnitude of his blunder. "But that's so unfair. I mean, I'm sorry I don't read sign language or eye language or whatever it is I'm trying too much to be an American clod to pick up on. But I was trying to say the right thing. You're always saying how important family are, right? So I thought if I mentioned mine, she'd at least realize I wasn't just some lone punk cruising the streets." "But it was a secret. They don't know I go with you. They would never allow it." "A 100% chaperone family outing? You have to sneak out for something like that?" She started walking down the hall. He followed. If it was such a terrible thing to do, why'd you do it?" She stopped and faced him, hurt. "Now you're mad with me because I'm risking a lot of trouble to be with you?" He reached to touch her shoulder, but she backed away, notebook for a shield. "Even I like you," she said softly. "Something that are okay for you are not okay for me. I must follow the wish of my family." He shifted from one foot to the other and looked down the hallway away from her. In the silence between them, she heard the dull hum of voices, the clinking of dishes from the cafeteria. The bell rang. "I must go," she said. "No, don't. We got to get this straight. Jonathan, mostly it's just because I'm white, right? Your aunt would like me better with black hair and brown eyes." "It's not just the color. You see, if you are Kimura, you would not ask me to go out with you in the first place." "Will you stop making that sound like such a crime? I can't believe all this is happening because I asked to take you for a one lousy drive in broad daylight." She sighed. "You see why I'd rather not talk about this? America is your country. You know how to act here. It's not right for me to tell you." "Just tell me why two people can't be friends." "I don't know. I only know we are taught that our elders know best." "But they don't. Not this time. Can't you see that?" "Jonathan, I don't like it you make me talk this way and argue. I warned you many times about this." I know. He shook his head. "I guess I just never figured you'd try so hard to stick to your old customs now that you're here. I thought you wanted to be more American." "I do, but I must obey my aunt and uncle." "But you're not in Cambodia anymore." She narrowed her eyes at him. "You think I need you to tell me this?" He sighed. "I'm sorry, but the whole thing makes me so mad. It's so unfair. Why should you be in trouble? You haven't done anything wrong. God, compared to most of the girls I know." A picture of Kathy flickered through her mind. Kathy with her hand in the back pocket of his jeans. "What am I supposed to do? Just let you walk away? Oh well, I didn't care about her anyway." "Jonathan." She never dreamed he'd be so upset, make such a scene. "You have everything. You don't need me and all my sad story." "But I do." Heaven help her if she let herself look into those eyes any longer. She'd be giving in again. "This is bad for both of us," she said. "I think now they write in the beginning. When you ask me, will I eat lunch with you, I should say no. Then we wouldn't have a hurt like this now." "But Sundara," she began to back away. "No use to argue, too late. They make me promise." She took a breath that burned her lungs. "They make me promise I never talk to you again." She turned and pushed blindly into the girls' room, her heart thudding.